Let me get started with the presentation. Like I said, we have about 2 hours. I'll try to go over everything, and of course, at the end, we'll do the questions. So, let me see if I'm hitting the right buttons on this computer. Thanks for coming to this meeting of PA. Wait a second. Photoholics or not? Oh, I'm sorry. This is the other present. This is my Thursday night present meeting. I'm sorry, but anyway. My name is Keith, and I'm a photoholic. I'm sure a lot of you are also, and I belong to Photoholics Anonymous. Now, we're always looking for new members, so if you meet this criteria, you burn through a 64-gigabyte card in a few minutes, you hide your new equipment in a brown paper bag from your spouse, or you know the difference between a bus stop and an F stop. If any of these criteria, you're welcome to join into Photoholics. Anyway, let's start in on our pet photography presentation. B&H Presents, and I'm from Keith Ibsen Photography. And this is gonna be on pet photography, obviously, as we said. And my information is right up there. However, there are cards here if you wanna take them with my email and contact information. If you do contact me, I will get back to you. I do answer all my emails. And just tell me that, you know, it's from the presentation, and I'll get back to you as fast as possible. Let me just talk about the pet market for a minute first to see what we're actually getting into. It's actually, as of 2014 and growing at about 5% per year, it was a $58 billion market, the pet market. Now, out of that, $340 million was for clothing. The pet clothing market, $340 million. It's hard to believe, but... And $5 billion of that is for non-food and non-medical, for other pet supplies and everything else. So you can see it's a fairly large industry to get into. And there are some pet photographers, people that specialize just in pets, and you can see why, because it's a growing market and people like them. And to a lot of people, the pet is a part of the family today, which we'll talk about. So this is a good market. Is there anybody looking to get into this as a profession? So I have a few people. Other people are just looking to photograph their pets, I guess, and other people's pets and that. Okay, well, we're gonna cover it from both ends, you know, from being the professional end, and we'll talk about along the line later on how to make money, how to get started from that end. But we'll also talk about just general pet photography. We'll talk about the equipment, etc. So a little bit on my background. First of all, that's me, just so you know that's me. Okay, I'm a professional photographer and illustrator for about 40 years. I started out with underwater photography. Whoops, what happened? Did I go too fast? And illustration. I'm a professional illustrator also, but my main photography started underwater, and I still do some of that today. I did it for books, magazines, and publications, which is a whole other form of photography. And then about 15 years ago, I started to make the transition into land photography and outdoor photography, etc. People stayed people, they just remained a little drier than when I used to shoot them. And as Dave mentioned, I supplied several models for several of the shoots they've had here at B&H in the past, where models were required. One time I had six models I needed to supply for an outdoor shoot at Central Park for them. You ever try to get six models together at the same time? You think pets are hard? Okay, and I still shoot other photography like macro photography, and I do workshops on these other types of photography also. I'm an NPS member, Nikon Professional Services, and I'm on the board for over 20 years of an animal rescue group, no-kill shelter, etc. So I've always been into animals, which got me into, of course, pet photography, as I love working with animals. And this is the league I belong to called the Animal Lovers League. They're on Long Island. And they've done a lot to rescue animals. They currently have 50 cats they just rescued from a hoarder's house. And then every one of them, the DA's office of Nassau County asked us to step in, and they gave us a temporary facility to house these animals, and they all needed medical attention. And they needed spay and neutering, all which we are doing for them. And then now we have to get all these 50 cats homes. So I've been spending some time down there, which we'll talk about, photographing these animals to get them online. So, and their information is the animalloversleague.us, I'm sorry, if anybody wants to look them up. And this workshop, it's not a basic camera course, so I'll cover the camera and photography, what's necessary in pets. You need to check your camera's manual for any specific things that the camera does. I can't go over every single camera today. Obviously, that would be impossible. They're all different. So we'll go over that. And it's not really a selfie program on the iPhone, although it will help you take better pictures no matter what camera that you're using. All right, on this, when we go over the program, you'll understand how to take better animal pictures. And those animals I'll basically focus on will be more cats and dogs. I was going to go on to maybe talk, because I photographed horses, I photographed birds and pets and that. But the majority of people today, it's going to be cats or dogs. Mainly dogs is one of the biggest today, although cats are very popular too. Probably a little more harder to photograph, but they're very popular. So the workshop, we'll cover the equipment involved and the camera settings and lenses, working with flash and light modifiers, setting up the photo session, working with the pets, and the post-production. That's a pretty good all-around presentation of what's going to be covered. So, like I said, no selfies. So if you see your cat with your iPhone, no selfies. Everybody does this. They take pictures of their pets, iPhone, point-and-shoot camera, whatever it is. What they do, obviously, like all of us, then they post it online for everybody to see, because it's a member of the family. It's our pet. So everybody wants to see our pet. So we post it online as a picture. But sometimes we need something better than just a picture online or a quick little snapshot. Some of us are looking to actually get something that we can really appreciate and keep. Unfortunately for pets, they usually don't live as long as us, which is one of the biggest, it's one of the greatest things to have a pet, but it's one of the biggest things to lose a pet. And that. So pet photography helps us. In fact, one of the pets I showed in the beginning of this is no longer with us. And I only shot him a couple of months ago. And we knew that he was on his way out. So that's why we wanted to do the shoot when we did. And the owner and we've already had our final meeting and picking out the final images, and now we're going to go into making the prints, etc., of him. And it's actually with three dogs. So, and I'm presenting, I know these people, I'm presenting them with a little memorial book that they're not expecting. I just felt that was the right thing to do on that. So, but it's all the all-important member of the family now. That's what pets are becoming. And they deserve a portrait or album of their own, not just the family themselves. So from pictures to photographs, what's the difference? How do we do this? Well, you can hire a professional pet photographer like myself, okay? But many of you may want to make some money at this too, which we talked about a little while ago. Or you want to just capture images of your own pet that are much better. And that's what we're going to try to help you out with today, so that you're getting more than that snapshot. And some of you may like the idea of, let's make some money at this. And there is money to be made in pet photography. As you saw the dollars and figures of what the business is as a whole, there is a fair amount of portion that's available to you. When they're spending $350 million for clothing, some of those people want pictures of animals in clothing. So keep that in mind. What makes the difference? Several things. First, the planning. Second, the camera and the lens selections make a difference. The lighting. And fourth, the background and the composition. That's what brings it from a picture to a photograph. This is not a quick shot that you're going to face. They put on Facebook, instead of Facebook, a little. These are for wall prints or for your own coffee table book. You may want to have more, like I said, if you're putting it out for somebody else, it's going to be a book for them. So it's going to be a matter of shooting a lot of images and then sorting through those images to get out a few good shots. Okay? And what it's mainly about is personality. Getting the personality out of the animal and working with them. And these are not usually things that happen in a matter of one or two shots. So if you think, you know, you're going to walk in, take two shots and walk home, that's a picture, not a photograph. Okay, first of all, to get the pro-style shots, the photos of your pet, you need to understand some things about the subject along with some photographic skills. You need to have some goals. You need a good understanding of your camera and its functions. So I will tell you to go over the camera and functions so they become secondhand to you, because you're going to have a lot to do to concentrate on the shots. So really get to know your camera, go through the, actually read the manual, or get a book, better yet, a book on the camera, which is sometimes better than the manuals because they're put together better, for easy for following. And some of those, and of course, there's a lot of stuff online today on cameras. There's a lot, and B&H has stuff too, that you can go to YouTube and it'll go over certain cameras and functions, okay? We'll go over what's the best camera and lens for the job. How do I light the subject? We'll talk about composition, posing, proper white balance we'll go over on this stuff. The pets or pets and the pre-meat. I can't mention this pre-meat enough, and I'll go over it in detail. And all important things to understand and present before clicking the shutter. These are all things you need to know before even clicking the shutter. So you have to go through that stuff first. To get that unique image, you need to, one thing is a good camera and lens. Besides that, you need patience and maybe a stiff drink. Yeah. Even the best trained pets don't give us the best poses, all right? But that being said, like I mentioned before, I've had models that were harder to work with. I'd rather work with some of the pets. Pets are trained better than some of the models. If you tell a pet to sit, they do. If you tell a model to sit, they stand. So, now look up, hold it. Well, that didn't happen that way. This is a matter of seconds, and a few seconds after this shot was taken of this puppy, five others joined him. So this was a matter of being ready, get the puppy out. We had a handler here, and we had other equipment set up to get the puppy's attention so he would look up. I was already in position and was able to pop off very quickly several shots. Lighting was already in position, and then take the shot and go through several of these. And of course, we got the one good shot where he's looking up and he got his attention and that. But it takes, like I said, it takes several shots to get this. They don't do this right away. And usually what they'll do is exactly the opposite. But a little bit of training using the right stuff, as we talk about through the program here, you'll be able to do stuff like this with your pet. Doesn't have to be, you know, or somebody else's pet. And like I said, not to worry. The seminar will guide you through the world of pet photography. Remember, they don't understand what you're saying. Well, dogs do, and so do cats. Cats, just as we know, just don't care. So it's that simple. The pre-meat, this I can't go over enough. First, see if the pet is dressed better than you are. If they're wearing a tux and you're not, you know that they are dressed better than you are, and you're already off to a bad start. But the pre-meat is a really, really important part of getting good animal photographs or pet photographs. The feel and look of the shoot, what the owner's looking for, prints, albums, both, family and pets, what you offer, bring samples. The next slide, I'll show you some samples. But this is where you start going over things like what it's going to be, what they're looking for. And then next we'll talk about your sales pitch, what you offer. They should know exactly what they're getting in for financially. There should be no surprises anywhere in the pet shoot when it comes to buying prints, when it comes to getting albums, when it comes to your shooting fee. All of this has to be discussed at the pre-meeting, all right? And you have to get at least a 50% deposit at this point, all right? So this is very important. This is also, you get some background on the pet's behavior. So here's where you start to interact with the pet. And this is a good place to also bring the camera to let the pet see the camera. Because some pets are afraid of cameras. It's that simple. So you can bring your camera, put it down, let the pet see it. You get to know him, find out what he's all about, find out if he's very rambunctious, if he's quiet. This is all things get to know. But if you really want to make, even if you don't want to make money at this, and it's a pet that you already know, a pre-meeting where you just go over this thing, these things are very important. But if it's a pet that you don't know, this is really, really a must. And if you're doing it for financial gain, this has to be done. You have to have the pre-meet so that everybody knows what they're getting into. You want to check out the location of where the pet shoot's going to be. Are you going to shoot in the person's home? Because I shoot, as it says here, about 99 to 95% of the time I'm shooting on location. I don't like to bring the pet into a studio, although I have done it on occasions, depending on what's going on. The pet is most comfortable in their environment. And you get your best shots when the animal is comfortable. When you start moving the animals, like take them to the vet, most animals don't like to go there. They don't like to be moved out of their environment. Now that environment could be an outside park, a beach, could be an outside location. I'm not saying it has to be in the house, all right? But if you're gonna use those locations, you wanna see those locations also ahead of time. This way you know what to set up for, you know what the situations are gonna be, you'll know what equipment to bring, okay? You don't wanna be surprised when you get there, because you're gonna have enough to do with getting photos of the animal. You don't wanna figure out what the background's gonna be and everything else when you get there and say, oh, if only I would have brought, okay? You know, that you can't be doing. You want to know what's happening. So you also have to inform the client what they need to do beforehand. And if possible, leave them a list of things to do. Walk the dog, groom the dog. Okay, groom the cat. I usually recommend don't feeding the dog or the cat beforehand, because you're going to be using treats in between for getting the animal to do what you want or reward them. So you want to go over all this with the owner. And this is also the time you want to set up the meeting to go over your images. Now, if you're going to sell this to a client, you're going to have to set up now. You're going to say, okay, in 10 days, we're going to meet on such and such a date. I will have gone through your images, and I would have, by that time, pared them down to my top selections, and that selection and amount is going to depend on what the client's needs are. If they want a photo book, obviously you need more images, and prints. So all depending, you will sort down from there and get those images. You will get a minor post-production on them so they look good, okay? And then you'll go through those final ones with the client and have that preset time. And then after that, you'll do the final touch-ups and go in and get your prints and or books made, and get your final payment also when you deliver everything. But you have to set this up. Don't let this go. If this goes for several weeks or a month, it's not gonna happen. It's like shooting portraits. This is no different than doing a portrait shoot, really. A lot of people do a portrait shoot and they say, but they didn't buy any pictures afterwards. Well, if you let it go too long, it's going to go out of mind. People have other things on their mind, other things they're doing. You have to have a preset time and stay on top and say, this is a reminder, a week ahead of time, we have a meeting to go over your, at such and such a time, to go over your shots from the images that we did. And then have them ready. And as I'm going to talk about in the next slide here, you're going to bring your sample products, okay? Could be sample books and albums, soft-covered books, hard-covered books. You're going to also bring sample images on canvas, acrylic, whatever you're promoting for your purchasing or for your clients, you're going to bring that stuff with you too. The smallest size print I'll bring is a 16 by 20. That's the smallest I'll bring for a client to see. I will not bring an 8x10. I will not bring a 5x7. Okay? I don't want to sell 5x7 prints. If somebody really wants a print of their animal, 16x20 or more is what you, because it's a portrait. And you're going to find a lot of people want a full-size portrait. All right? So I bring a larger set of prints for people to see. It looks more impressive. They understand the size. When you just say 8x10 or whatever, 60, or, you know, they don't understand how that relates to where, you know, it's going. And at your pre-meeting, you're also going to try to find out where, if they want a print, where is it going? Okay? So that helps that you select the best print for that location for them. Because you're going to be giving them a lot of choices. But it's up to you as a professional to say from where you're putting this or what type of group you're putting together here. And it could be a group of shots. Could be several different ways that you can do this. Could be on acrylic. It could be on canvas. There's a lot of stuff available today. Could be on metal. You know, we print on a lot of different materials today for different looks. So it's going to be up to you to help them make the final selection. Again, by looking at the area that it's going on. And then if you have to measure the area and make sure you have a sample print of that size. It may not be their print, obviously, but you have something they can see how it would go and how it would fit into that area. But I'm also prepared to go back because I guarantee them that I'll get them good shots. And is it possible that you don't when you first go there? I don't care how good you are. Yeah, it's possible. Things are not going right. The day wasn't right. The pet wasn't right. You weren't right. Something was just not right. And I'm guaranteeing when I talk to my client and charge them that I'm going to give them what they need. And if that means I have to go back because things weren't right, then I'll go back. This is also why you don't want to give your work away. If you're doing this for $50, forget it. You know, talking about several $100 here just to come and do a shot, pet photo. And we'll talk about that as we move on. Model release, yes, a model release for the pet. The owner sign a model release. You may want to be able to use these other than for your own promotion. They may want to be able to use these images for commercial use. So there is a model release. I'll post this one online in case anybody wants to see it and use it and make some changes to it with their own name, etc. I'll put it on my website for people to look at. But you want to have that model release. I actually have all this in a little package I'm redoing right now. You also want to have business cards. More than one. Now, why would you want to have more than one? Because people have friends. You give them one business card, they keep it. If you give them a couple of business cards with the idea and let them know, it would be nice if they passed on the information to other pet owners because they usually know other pet owners. And it's word of mouth, they have a card they can give so people can contact you. So bring more than one business card to give to people at all times. And when you shoot family pets, if you're going to get into this for a business, make sure your family also refers you. Don't feel down when you first get started. It takes time to get used to everything. You'll take 100 photos, you may get 10 good ones. It's just the way it is when you're shooting pets. The trick is being a professional. You take a lot of shots, and this doesn't really change really on anything, to get a few excellent ones. And like I said, be prepared to come back and shoot some more if necessary. This is just like any other portrait session. And that, you know, sometimes that you have to shoot, you know, as a professional, how many shoot one shot of the person and say, okay, we're done? It doesn't happen. It's certainly not going to happen with pets. Good place to start. How can I practice taking pets, photographs of cats if I have a dog? Where can I find subjects? Local animal shelter is a good place to start. This is a place where you can actually, they're usually looking for people to take pictures of their animals that they can post online. So if you have a local animal shelter that you can work with, or you can contact local animal shelters in your area and say, is it possible for me to come in? And if you have some images that you can show them on an iPad, etc., or a brochure or a business card, to show what you're doing, they're usually more than happy to let you come in and work with the animals. So this way you can get practice working with animals other than what you have. So I usually recommend that you do this. And in fact, a lot of the shots, some of the shots here were taken at shelters. Shelter shooting is a little bit different. For the most part, the animals are in cages, which tend to be distracting. However, if you shoot, I usually shoot, like with the cats, I use a 105 macro 2.8 lens. And you can see I get the cage in the background blurred out pretty good. Okay, but this is not something that I'm looking to make a print out of. I'm just looking to get a really good shot you can put on the web to help get these animals adopted. And that. So I find that working with that type of longer lens, a macro lens like that, especially on smaller animals, and having a fast lens, which I like to do on dogs also, gives me better images. So, what's in my bag? Let's start with the equipment necessary to accomplish pet photography and not just snapshots. Oh, did I go too fast? Let me see. Let me move ahead here. Shelter shooting we just did. Sorry about that. What's in my bag? Okay. There we go. Don't overdo it with your equipment. You know, some people get more equipment than they actually need. You don't want to do that. So, you know, make sure you bring along just what you need, because you're going to have other things besides photographic equipment to bring with you, which I'll talk about later. Some of the other pet equipment or pet things that you should bring with you to work with animals. So don't overburden yourself. And again, the pre-meeting. So it all goes back to that pre-meeting, so you know what to bring, so you're not overpacking yourself down like with the, you know, 30 pounds of equipment. And that since you are shooting on location, you want to be as mobile as possible lots of times. Okay. Bags, I use a rolling bag and a backpack, all depending on where I'm going. My bag's a choice of Think Tank. Tripods, I use an Arc Swiss ball head. That's, again, personal. These are personal choices. I'm not saying you have to use this and that, but I don't shoot with a tripod when I'm shooting the animals, because the animals are moving. If I'm on a tripod, I can't follow an animal. And that, I keep a tripod there in between to hold my camera if I'm doing something else, or I'll attach a wireless triggering device, maybe a computer if I'm shooting tethered, or I'll use it to hold a tablet, because I'll shoot wireless with a cam ranger, which I'll talk about later. That wirelessly sends the image to my tablet. I prefer to do that stuff so we can see the image larger than on the back of my little 3.5-inch screen, which everything looks good on. So I prefer to have a tablet with me and shoot wireless to it, or, like I said, shoot tethered shooting. We'll talk a little bit about tethered shooting later on and some of the equipment I recommend for that. And that. I have two full-frame cameras I use, and I'm using Nikon. I'm not saying you have to have Nikon. I'm also not saying that you have to have full-frame. You don't necessarily have to have full-frame cameras, no. Just what I shoot with for my other stuff and for this, that's what I have. I got a D600 and 800. My most common lenses and I recommend is a 24-70, which is probably my most popular lens, what I shoot with. I also use a 70-200 and the 105 macro, and believe it or not, a 14-24 wide-angle lens. Now, most times you're saying, wait a second, 14-24, that's a wide-angle lens. It's awful wide. You would never shoot a person with a wide-angle lens like that. They would distort. But on pets, they look kind of cute. So there's occasions I'll pull out the wide-angle lens. I've even pulled out a 16. And use that and get the animal right up to the lens. Because on an animal, they look a little funny, yeah, but it looks a little cute. On a person, it just looks a little funny. They don't look a little cute. There's a difference. So wide-angle lens I'll use. They're all fast lenses. They're 2.8 lenses, so I can blur backgrounds when necessary. I have at least four flashes I use, and they're all speed lights. I shoot speed lights. I do that because of portability. Like I said, I'm shooting portable location most of the time. These are lightweight. There are a lot of, I'm not saying this is what you have to do. This is what I prefer to do. There are a lot of flashes and strobes, studio style strobes coming out today. They have their own built-in battery pack, and they do have a lot of the same features at speed lights. Profoto has one called the B1. That actually has TTL for Nikon and Canon, I think Sony too now, and they actually sync up to 1/8000th of a second. So there is some studio strobes out there that you could use if you want. They are going to be a little bit bigger than that. So it's just a matter of what you're willing to deal with and carry, etc. But again, don't take 4 to 6 strobes if you know that you can accomplish it with 3. But if you accomplish it with 3, take 4. In case one is not working right. I always have 2 cameras with me. I always have 2 cameras. I usually have 2 different lenses on them, but I have 2 cameras. And that, just in case something goes wrong, I mean, with one camera, no matter how good you take care of it, if you're using it constantly, something can happen. So if you can have a second camera, have a second camera. And I use wireless flash triggers. I happen to use the Fotex ones for Nikon. These are not line of sight, these are radio controlled. Some of your cameras will have built-in wireless transmissions. Some Nikons have that where you can use line of sight, okay? But you can also, I prefer the radio controlled units because then I can take my flash and I can put it behind a tree. I can put it in a door. I can do wherever I want, and within a certain feet, up to like 300 feet, it'll fire. It can be down the block for all I care, and it'll fire, and that. And I want to make sure it's going to fire. And these are pretty reliable. I used to use the old Pocket Wizards, were very popular, and they're still around. But I can buy like 2 or 3 of these for the same price as a Pocket Wizard, and it does just as good a job. And that, especially when you have a lot of flashes. So it's just a recommendation. Again, it's not the only one around. And again, you can talk to the people here at B&H to find something within, because there's other ones that would probably be in a price bracket for you that would work as well. So you ask the people that are working and selling it behind the counter for recommendations on exact brands and that. So I also use a macro ring some of the times. If you've ever seen that, that's the ring that goes on the front of the flash itself. Okay. In fact, when I use the 105 macro lens, I use the macro ring. If you try to use the flash on top of your camera, it's probably the worst flash in the world. First of all, if you have a long lens, it tends to cast a shadow on the subject because the flash is actually hitting the front of the lens if you get too close, especially on macro. So I usually never, the only time I use the flash on top of the camera is when I'm using that as a signaling device to fire off camera flashes. But I'm not a big person for popping up my flash on the camera. It's a very, very small flash, very, very harsh light. And that light is also where you get the red eye in the eyes, especially in the pets, etc. So I prefer to shoot off camera where I can eliminate that, shoot different angles, and get a better photograph. And any of this equipment you can see outside, backgrounds, I usually shoot paper in most cases when I'm working with the pets, because sometimes pets can be messy and you have to cut it off. You don't want to cut your cloth background. So again, it all depends on the animal personality. Again, what you're looking to do. Sometimes there's no background because the background's outside and that. But when I'm shooting inside, lots of times I'll shoot with paper. So if I have to dispose of it, it's just a matter of cutting it off and redoing it, not a problem. And then there's the lighting systems I use, I'll talk about some modifiers, one called the Apollo, and then the Rogue flash benders. I'll talk about those. They're lightweight, yet they give softer light than just trying to use the flat, plain flash. Because even the off-camera flashes themselves can be very harsh on animal photography. So the camera itself doesn't have to be the most expensive camera in the world. but it should be at least a digital SLR or a mirrorless. One with interchangeable lens. Now, I'm not saying you can't use a point-and-shoot camera, that it will not work. You can. There are some decent point-and-shoots out there. But the whole idea is basically to get better pictures. Usually you need something where you can interchangeable to get the right lens for the right job. And when the lens is fixed, sometimes that's not possible. Although some of the digital cameras today, the point-and-shoots are coming out with much better lenses. But they still don't meet the quality of the lens that you get on a SLR or even the new mirrorless cameras. And the mirrorless are becoming, do people know what a mirrorless camera is today? Well, if you know what digital SLR is? Okay, it has the mirror inside that you look through and you get a prism and you look up and you see what the subject is. The new mirrorless cameras today, basically, you're looking at a digital image. There's no mirror in there. The cameras are smaller, lighter, weight. They still can be full frame. Sony has full frame cameras and mirrorless. A lot of people like them because it's not as big and bulky. But it's like looking, when you're looking in the viewfinder or the back of the LCD, either one, okay, it's like looking at a movie. But on the other hand, when you make changes in the f-stop or shutter speed, you actually see the change happening. So a lot of people like the mirrorless. I personally am not a mirrorless camera person because I've always grown up on the digital SLR, and to me it's just kind of foreign. But a lot of people today are moving that way. It's going to be a lighter camera if weight is a problem for you, so you may want to think about that. And they do have a fair amount now of different lenses available for these mirrorless cameras made by not only the company but a lot of third-party manufacturers. So it's something to look at. Again, staff outside can help you with selections. I'm not going to go over that. Let's see. I said it doesn't need to be full frame. It must meet your demands. You're going to be shooting a lot of outside. You're doing a lot of shooting. If you're doing it professionally, you want to have something that's heavy duty, weather sealed, etc. And that. If not, there's plenty of other cameras that'll do the job for you. There's plenty. It should have at least an APS-C size sensor. Sensor size makes a difference. I'm not going to teach a camera class here, but if you talk to people outside, they'll tell you the different size sensors in cameras and why they have full frame, APS, and point and shoot. Point and shoot only allows you to go so far in an image. A lot of people talk about the pixels. You know, they'll say, well, my point and shoot is 16 megapixels, and your SLR there is 16 megapixels, so they take the same picture. Well, when you look at the sensor in the point and shoot, and it's this big, and on the SLR it's this big, the size of those pixels are different. So 16 doesn't equal 16. Okay, so it's the size of the sensor that has a lot to do with the quality and how big you can blow up the image. So if you're going professional, it has to be at least an APS size, APS-C size or bigger on the camera. And Nikon, Canon, they're all good. Sony makes the, like I said, is big into the mirrorless cameras. Okay, and this is one that has the espresso maker built in, which is the newest thing coming out, and the cup holder. Let's talk about lenses. This is important. There's a vast assortment of lenses today. A large selection of manufacturers making them. How do you choose? The best way is by the subject being photographed. That's how you choose a lens. Don't just buy a lens because it's new. Whether you're shooting pet photography or anything else, you buy the lens by what you're going to be shooting. So here, for instance, got my widest lens. Okay. Didn't give you a choice there. You know, the widest lens, wide cat. PET lenses. Okay, what do I recommend for PET lenses? The best lenses for PET photography. Well, first of all, the lens is one of the most important items you'll buy, because no matter how good the camera is, if you don't have a real good lens, you'll lose quality. That's why some lenses are $300 and some are $1,000. Okay, and there's a range in between. You buy what you can afford, you buy for what you're going to do, but there's certain lenses that I'm going to recommend on far as size goes, and that some of those I've mentioned already quickly. But they don't always have to be the lens for from the manufacturer, as I'll talk about. Fast glass. You know what I mean by fast glass? Everybody pretty much know. In other words, it's going to be like 2.8 or at least f4 at the lowest. so that you can get that blurred background. Because lots of times you're shooting a photo like this, and the background really isn't that important. It's not that interesting. So you want to be able to blur that background to get the animal to really show. So you want fast glass. Okay. There's a mistake in this. I recommend it's not the 25-105, it's the 24-105. Typo on my side. And that the 24-70, like I mentioned, the 7200 and 105, and they're all fast lenses, and like I said, the 14-24. But it can be third-party lenses. There are some excellent third-party lenses out there today, not made by the manufacturers, that cost a lot less money, but will give you excellent, excellent images. You have Tamron, you have Sigma. Those are a few of the companies. So if you have a Nikon camera and you look at a 24-70, Nikon's $2,000-something. The Sigma is, I think, about $900, $800. But Sigma makes lenses. That's what they do. They make them from Nikon, Canon, Sony, etc. So you don't always have to buy the most expensive lens to get a good quality lens. And that. So keep that in mind. I get that lens to use the zoom, basically. I prefer. Some people like to shoot fixed lenses, and the zoom is their feet. They want to get in, they walk, they want to back up, you know, they zoom out. So I prefer, because dealing with pets, I don't want to be moving up to them sometimes. It could scare them or change everything. So I'd rather be in position. And sometimes I'm in position and I'm shooting a picture where I'm shooting maybe 3/4 to the full pet. And from that same position, I want to get a portrait only. I don't want to have to get up and come up. A lot can happen in that time with a pet where they move. Here I can just zoom in and shoot the images. So I prefer to do it that way. And you don't want to move around once you get in position. It's a run and gun type of shooting when you're doing it sometimes. Sometimes you're moving around with the pet, you know, and you're just shooting as you get, you know, they're moving around, you're moving around a little bit, and all of a sudden everything gets in position, you take the shot. And that, you know, hopefully, you know, with the trainer and everybody there, as we talk about, and the proper other tools, you'll get the pet to do what you want. But sometimes, like I explained before, I was talking about, I had a shoot where I was doing for a fundraiser, and we were shooting in January outside in the tent, okay? And I had 15 minutes per dog to shoot. So what I had to do was preset my background and my lighting, and then have each animal into that set and shoot as many shots as I could in that short period of time, and I got images on every animal. And that, but I had to preset to do that. But I had to move around sometimes physically with the animals. And that I didn't have a trainer there. I had just the owners. Oh. You know, and you'd think you got the perfect shot and then realize the owner just stood in front of your flash. You know, that's why, again, the pre-meeting is very important, to go over with the owner what their responsibility is doing the shoots. You need them there for the pet, because they respond to the owner. But if you can have a professional pet trainer there that knows what you do for photography, that can help a lot. But if the owner's going to be there, you got to tell them where to stand and what to do. Okay? And that place is directly behind you. Because where do you want the animal to look? At you. Yeah. So if you have them stand to the left, where's the animal going to look? To the left. So you got to let the owner know, if you're going to be here, you're going to stand behind me, all right? If I move this way, you're going to move that way. So you're going to let them know ahead of time. But when you don't, or they just going to do something on their own, you find things that you think you got a good shot, and then the owner was in the way, or they tried to help. You know, so you got to really set down the ground rules for them, so you can pull out as many shots as possible. Okay. Okay. Camera settings. We'll talk about camera settings quick. What settings should my camera be on? Number one, not the green auto mode. If you're shooting green auto mode, you're just taking pictures. I mean, that's nothing wrong. Sometimes that's all you want to do is get a picture of something they're doing. But that's not going to, in most cases, put something on the wall for you that you're really going to be proud of, or put something in an album. Aperture priority. The background makes a choice for you. I use aperture priority if the background, for some reason, is very, very distracting. but the pet's there and I need the shot, then I go for my widest aperture if possible. Like 2.8 for shallow depth of field. No distractions. I may use a greater depth of field, like f8 and up, because that'll give me my greatest sharpness throughout the picture. When I'm shooting on some of these lenses with a very wide open lens, if a pet turns slightly, I may get one eye in focus and one eye out of focus. Because some of these lenses, like the 105 macro, will have a very, very shallow depth of field. You know, so we got to keep all that in mind when we're shooting with the pet. What do I need? Do I need a really sharp image of the pet? Do I need to blur that background, etc.? My personal choice is I shoot on manual. My camera goes on manual, and I adjust my shutter speed and f-stops accordingly. And I shoot in RAW, and sometimes RAW and JPEG when I'm shooting tethered. Majority of time, I still use single servo focusing over continuous tracking. However, if the subject is moving, and that's the image I need, I'll select the focus tracking mode. So some cameras have a way of tracking your subject. Depending on the camera, it'll give you so many focus points that allow you to track. Like if you're shooting a bird in flight, some cameras have tracking modes. A lot of the digital SLRs today have a tracking mode and that, and focusing, down in the focus. Now, where it is on your camera, again, you gotta look onto your manual to find out. There are different places on different cameras where you can set it for continuous. So you set one point, and it'll have anywhere from maybe 11, 12 to 14 and up points, that as the subject then moves after you select the first point, the camera knows what that is and it follows the subject for you. Which is great if you're shooting like you want to get a dog on the run coming towards you. You can't focus on it each step it goes. If you're trying to focus that, you can't do it. You need the camera that's going to actually track them. And then you're going to shoot continuous or speed also, along with that. That'll allow you to focus on an animal. Like lots of times I'll have somebody have an animal come running towards me, and I'll be set up shooting, and I'll go click, 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 click. That's when you hear that machine guns and that. And the camera's actually focusing, tracking. And it's usually pretty good, not 100% all the time, so it's usually not a one-shot deal. It's usually not come towards me, take the shots, let's move on to something else. It's usually that, come towards me, okay, let's do it again, come towards me. And you'll shoot usually several times to get a couple of images out of that. Even though the focus tracking may be on, the feet weren't just right, the head was turned a little bit. So again, be prepared for more than just one set of shots. And here's where you want the owner, again, behind you, and somebody else helping. So, okay, because the dog is going to be coming running for you. You may want somebody to be holding the dog, and then let the dog go so that it comes to the owner as the owner calls. And you're there with your camera, you know, tracking them and focusing. So then I'll use that tracking continuous mode. When the animal's sitting in a single space, not moving too much, I'll usually shoot on single, you know, on it. It's the way I work, but you may find it easier just to continuous. Some of this you're gonna have to develop your own style on. Getting the white balance correct. Everybody knows what white balance is? Proper color tones. Since I use flash most of the time, I set the white balance on daylight or flash. However, I do use a color checker. I shoot that first. So that if I do have to make any corrections, especially with raw images, I can make that in post-production. That's very important. And that, so I get just the right color tones throughout the image. And that. Now this obviously was shot with the background inside. This was a shelter pet, by the way. That was a shelter pet. And that, working with a puppy at the shelter. And believe me, getting puppies to sit like that is not easy, because they want to be all over the place. Choosing the right ISO. Anybody knows what ISO is? That's like the speed of in the old days, film. And that I try to shoot when I'm looking for the sharpest image. So I try to shoot at the lowest ISO for the area I'm shooting in that I can do. If it's 100, I'll try to shoot at 100. But everything's relevant to what the image is going to be and where you're shooting. So sometimes I'll shoot at 400 or 800. But I always try to go for the lowest so that I get the sharpest image possible. Okay? However, somebody once said that if somebody notices all the noise in the shot, it's not a good shot. If that's what they notice first, it's not a good image. So sometimes you shoot a very high ISO, there may be a lot of noise, but the image itself is unbelievable, and that's fine. So that's okay. Some cameras have an auto ISO where you change the f-stop and shutter and adjust the ISO for you. I don't use it. It's not my type of shooting. But again, it's available in some cameras. Some people may like to use it. If that's the case, check your manual. It'll show you how to set up and use that. So where you can pick your settings or both your shutter speed and your f-stop, and it'll adjust the ISO automatically for you. So if your camera has that, it may be something you like to do. And that particular dog that you saw there is no longer with us, unfortunately. So that's why we shot him when we could. We knew he was, he's blind, by the way. He's blind. And that, so, that's the sad part about some of this. Lighting. That's what photography is all about, is the lighting. That's what it's all about. And lighting for pets is like lighting for anything else, for portraits or anything else. You want to have the best lighting that you're going to get. As you know, dark subjects like this, they tend to absorb light. So you may have to make corrections for there. So if you're shooting a lot of animals and you preset with your shots, if a light animal comes up opposed to dark ones, be ready to make corrections. So you can't use the same f-stop and shutter speed because the animal is going to reflect light differently as opposed to this, white on white. Yeah, a little more difficult, but I like to shoot like white on white, black on black. I just think it makes a very nice image. And again, though, you have to make sure I'm still getting shadows in there to give some texture and some shape to the animal. I got them blending into the background somewhat, but on the other hand, I still have to have areas that show and define the animal. Yeah, usually stop sometimes. It all depends on how bright the animal is, what you're doing. Plus, I got a white background, give me a lot of reflection. I'm lighting the background too, in this case. Because I want to, if you shoot a white background, if you don't light it, there's a good chance it's not going to show up white. I look at the histogram quickly, yes, I do. I look at the histogram, but I just basically look at the back of the picture and take a look at it, but I look at the histogram too to see if how my tones are, because it's gonna show an overexposure. It's gonna be more, on this picture, it's gonna be more to the left because everything's so white. So it may be confusing and say, oh, it looks like everything is just too overexposed and that, but that's the image. It really is gonna show that way and that's proper to get that all white on white. You're not going to see any really dark areas coming up on the right-hand side on your histogram. So it's partly reading the histogram and partly reading the image, but that's another reason I like to shoot tethered when I can to like a large tablet, because now I'm not looking at this little thing, I'm looking at this. And I can really get a good size image to see how things are coming out and make my adjustment, third of a stop, a full stop, whatever it's going to do, or moving a light. Because sometimes to get the shadows right, it's just getting the light and moving the light right. But you know, you can make a white background black. If you move the animal far enough away from it and you don't light it, you can turn your white background to a black background. If you're shooting tethered without going wireless, it tends to be faster transmission to the computer and that. And I'll talk about tethered shooting. There's some devices that you should have when you're shooting tethered, but you're still just holding the camera. And then there's the only cord you have, because everything else I shoot is wireless. Like all the flashes are wireless. I don't do any wire to the flashes at all. That all has to be wireless. It's either through optically or through radio controlled. Because you don't want to have a lot of cords around. One tethering is fine, but you can't have cords all over the place because you're moving around a lot sometimes. But you're not working in big areas usually with the animals, unless you're outside. Then you're taking in a background too, and then you're working in a larger area. So these are all things you got to compensate for. That's why the pre-meet and the location, to find out, am I going to shoot tethered, or is this not going to allow me to shoot tethered in this area? Okay? So you have to know what to bring. That's why that pre-meet is so important. And basically, I've actually had that where I've had the two different colors, and you have to take a few shots for balancing it. You can use your light meter of both, but obviously one's going to give you different reflection than the other. So it's actually a balancing act that you can do, but you can get them both in. And again, it's depending on what background you're going to use, too. If you're going to shoot on a high-key background, obviously the black dog is going to show really contrast against, and the white's going to blend in. So it's a matter of adjusting. What I usually do is bracket my exposures. That's what I usually do at that point. I take a reading, take a couple of shots, and look at it, and then I try to bracket my exposures to compensate. And then post-production, I may have to do a little bit more work. There's always post-production to think about it, okay? Today, I'm used to shooting film, so I'm used to getting 99% of my images in camera. Because back in the old days, you could do dodging and burning a little bit, but you didn't have all the compensations we can do today with the digital photography, with Photoshop and everything else. I'm not a big, okay, let's Photoshop it guy. I try to do as little of that as possible, because all that takes a lot of extra time. If you have a lot of images and you're spending a lot of time in Photoshop, it's crazy. And that. But there may be times when you're doing something like that where you know you're going to have to do a little bit of dodging and burning in Photoshop to balance out everything. And that. So you do the best you can, but it does come up. Available light? Well, that's any light that's available. Could be the sun, could be a strobe. If it's outside, I still like to shoot early morning or late day, just like any portrait. I don't like midday sun when the light is harsh and it's harsh shadows and everything else. If possible, if I have an assistant with me, we'll bring a diffuser, all depending on the shot that's being done, etc. So I still try to prefer shoot during the key times of the day, not daylight, not like midday on the beach. You know, it's usually not a good time to shoot. But if you have to, plan on it. Bring the proper equipment to do it. Bring a diffuser so that you can get some shade over the animal to diffuse the light, so it's not quite as sharp, not as harsh, etc. I can usually pretty much get used to it and say, like, you know, I'm going to set this for 5-6. And shoot this shot and at 1/25th, and I'm going to light the background. I'm usually going to pretty much right on. I just, from doing it, I pretty much know that this animal I'm going to shoot like at 5-6, and I'm going to shoot, obviously, if I want the background white, I'm going to shoot a slower shutter speed, because the shutter speed affects my background light. On the other hand, I'll have a shot later on where I actually knocked out the background completely. I shot out at a high-speed sync on a black dog. But I need more lights to do that, to light the dog, but then the background was gone. And that, so it's just a matter of getting used to that. If you can, you know, or else, like I said, shoot at a, like f2.8, etc. You know, use a lens that has a fast lens, so that background, basically on a longer lens, like a 7200, if you shoot on that at f2.8 and then set your shutter speed accordingly, which means you're going to have a faster shutter speed to compensate for the wide open lens, or you may actually have to throw on top of that, you may have to get a filter, a variable filter that will actually allow you to shoot at higher f-stop, and then that way you can get a blurrier background. Because lots of times when I'm shooting outside, I'll shoot like a 7200, and I'll shoot at f2.8, and I'll get a slow, and I'll basically have to speed up my shutter speed so that I get a proper exposure, but I want that background. My main concern is the background shouldn't be sharp, because it's too confusing or not nice. It makes the animal pop. You want the animal to pop. And then the other thing we'll talk about is cropping. So lots of times you'll take a picture knowing, and this is where a sharp lens and a good process, sensor comes in, that sometimes it's going to be a great shot, but there's a lot of stuff in the image that's not important. So you're going to think about, when you take the shot, I know that I'm going to crop this later. Because that's something we did in film. We cropped. And we still do it here. So sometimes you'll take a shot that's actually a cropped image. You know it, and you take it that you're going to crop it to get a better image. That's part of post-production. Like, that's a cropped image. That's a cropped image on a background. And if you see the background is kind of, the background was sharp, it really wouldn't be that much of a, it wouldn't be a great background. So what's in focus there is basically the eyes of the dog and the dog himself. And then I basically just cropped him in because there was a lot more going on around him. But to get the shot where he was and what he was doing, I shot it. Knowing that when I got to the computer, it wasn't going to be, all the other stuff wasn't going to be in there. I was going to be cutting it out as much as possible. So it's cropped down. And then I like adding a vignette. I put a vignette around it. Again, that helped them pop out a little bit more. So these are all things you have to think about when you look at the image. And that sometimes you may change something into a black and white image too. I've done that too, where I've looked at the image and say, you know, this will look better black and white than in color. But you always shoot in color, even if you're going to present the black and white to the customer, because they may say, oh, gee, I love this, but I wish it was in color. And if you shot it only in black and white, sometimes you go, oh, okay. This way you can always say, okay, I have it in color. Because you can always make a color of black and white, but sometimes you can't go the other way around. Using flash, but not the one built into the camera. Speed lights are my lights of choice, because they're small, compact. And you can usually buy a lot of them for the price of one professional strobe. And again, these are going to be choices on your part. But they do allow you, even if you have to use it on top of the camera, they still swivel and move, etc. So they give you more lighting options than a pop-up flash. And they range in price from $70 to $500, $600. And the one that you need is going to depend on what type of shooting you're going to do, what you're looking for, etc. And I'm not going to tell you which one to buy. That you go outside and you discuss with the people outside. For me, I use the Nikon ones and I use Fotex because they have a lot of, they do TTL, through the lens metering, which I use lots of times. So if an animal's coming forward towards me, there's no way I can adjust the exposure on the flash if an animal's running towards me. But with a flash that's TTL, it's automatically measuring that light and it's changing it automatically. So I prefer to have that TTL capability in there, put it on TTL, and as the animal gets closer, obviously I need less flash power for the animal, right? So instead of me sitting there trying to hit the button on the flash all the time, all I do is shoot, and the flash is automatically calculating the amount of exposure. Most times it's pretty good. Sometimes I usually set it, though, -1 over what it selects, my personal choice, because I don't want it to look like there was a flash. I want the light to light up the animal and give a little punch in the eye, but I don't want it to be so bright that you say, oh, he flashed that and that. So these type of units will do that, and they also allow for bounce lighting. We know what that is. You turn it, you bounce off a wall or a ceiling, etc. So all of these flashes allow for that. Why a flash and why off camera? Well, basically I explained, because basically what you're going to get is you're going to get something that's going to give you better lighting controls. It's going to allow you to use light modifiers, and I'll talk about modifiers in a second rather than just the light itself. When I shoot cats, I like to shoot the a macro kit like this, especially if they're at the shelter, because I can get all that inside the cage and light the cat, and it has TTL, and I can shoot at f2.8. And I can blur the background and light the cat and get the lights. And because you want to get some light in the eyes. That's the thing. You don't want those black eyes, those dead eye looks. And a flash will always allow you to kick some light into eyes. You always want the eyes to have some type of reflection to them, some type of life to them. And flashes allow you to do that. Now, this particular macro kit runs around, I think it's about $800 or $900. But you can get one that runs $40 that'll work for you. So there's different ones. You don't have to spend thousands of dollars to do this. So if you're doing it for fun, you know, there's macro kits that are inexpensive. There's ways to set that stuff up. There's all different ways to do it, to get into it from a reasonable point of view and a reasonable price range. So everything's relevant to what you're going to be doing with the final pictures and what you're going to do. You're not going to spend several thousand dollars to take pictures of your own dog or of a family pet, etc. but you can still get some nice equipment where you can get more than just a general snapshot. Okay? And then we'll talk about light modifiers to make these even better. One of them that's inexpensive and easy to use is called a Rogue Flash Bender. And as you can see, these just fit around the flash. And what they do is they make the light larger. The flash bounces up into the top. You can bend these. They bend. So you can bend them forward, cup them. You can do stuff with them. And that now, instead of the light being this big, it's this big. The bigger the light, the closer the light, the softer the light. It's that simple. So if you can get the bigger light, softer light, and get it closer, it'll give you a better image. And this is an inexpensive way to give you better lighting on your pets without going through a lot of money. These are maybe $40, $50, if that. And they fit right on top of your flash, which you can put on top of your camera, put it on a stand, put it alongside, and use these. They're not big expensive. They're very portable. They fit in a bag very easily. They're flat. And they just use Velcro to go around the most of the flashes and that. So I find these very useful when I have to do something quick, small, and easy. This is one of the modifiers. Another one that's pretty popular is called Gary Fong. You may have seen this. It looks like Tupperware. They fold flat. They go on top of the flash again. These tend to work very well, too, because they give you a larger light. The one on the white one on the right is it's round, like Tupperware almost. It fits on very tightly, but it spreads the light all around. It doesn't direct the light in any certain direction. It just sort of spreads it. And that sometimes you want to control the light. The black one, on the other hand, if you know, it looks like little grids on the top, that'll direct the light. So if you want to just focus the light on one area of an animal or a scene, the black one will focus the light so that the rest of the scene goes dark, and then you have like a spotlight effect. It would be very nice. Like if you want to have an animal in the woods, and the woods you want to have sort of dark around them, and just the animal popping out, then like the black one would work. And again, these are like $40 or $50. These are not very expensive, and they fit almost any of the external flashes. But they're different items I keep with me, and again, depending on what I'm going to do, I may have more than one modifier with me, because I may plan to do more than, I usually have planned to do more than one type of shot of an animal. And again, pre-meet. It's all determined when I do my pre-meet. I make my notes at my pre-meet of what things I think I should be bringing for the actual shoot, depending on what we're going to do. Especially if we're shooting an animal, I have to have a lot of different shots. If we're going to shoot for an album, I can't have the same shot 20 times. So I have to have different lighting effects, so I have to have other things that I can take with me that I can use, and some of these items work out very, very well. Now there's other items too that also, the Rogue Flash Bender also has an item that will work like the black one, but it's smaller and a little bit lighter. I also bring that too, I have that also. All depending on what my needs are. My favorite unit, especially if I'm shooting inside, is called a Westcott Rapid Box. These are soft boxes. You see these used in studios a lot, and I've used them outside also. But I use them in studio and outside. What I like about these units, if you've seen soft boxes, they're very hard to set up. They have a rod inside that you have to bend to get fit into a round circle. These open like an umbrella. Just like you open an umbrella. But when they pop open, they turn into a box. A soft box. This is a strip box style. Okay? So it gives light in a strip. And again, it allows, you can put your speed light right on the back of it, the special bracket to fit it, and then mount it onto a light stand. And now you can set this up and set it vertically or horizontally, depending on how you're shooting the animal. But now, instead of shooting a little light like this, this is 10 inches by 24 inches. So now your light is really spread out. So again, it's bigger, closer, softer. It's going to be nicer light. It's not going to be as harsh on the subject. And you're lighting more of the subject. So one light sometimes will cover everything you need for the day. So they make this in several different styles. They make the 1024. They make a 20 or 26 octo, which you can see the shape of. It looks like an octagon. Silver inside for reflection. and again, has the same mounting in the back. It does have a cloth that fits on the outside so that you can soften the light, which you usually want to put that cloth on to spread the light and soften it. And again, it opens up and closes like an umbrella. So if I have to go someplace and set these up, I'm not doing a big production. I'm opening it like an umbrella, closing it like an umbrella, dropping it onto a light stand. I can carry it around, I can take it outside, I can shoot inside, I can do a lot of different things. Which one I use depends on why I'm shooting. Sometimes I'm using more than one, up to three or four. But which I'm using where depends on how the animal is being photographed. When an animal's laying down, I may use the strip horizontal. Or if I want to shoot a portrait, I may then use the, one of the octos, because they're great for portraits. And when you look in the eyes, if you look in the eyes, even if you shoot models, you shoot magazines, you can usually tell the lighting by looking in the model's eyes on the magazine. You see the reflection of the lighting used, either square or octo. But you want the same to happen with pets. You want that light in the eyes. You want some life in the eyes. So depending on which one you use will depend on what type of reflection you get from the eyes. And they have a 32 duo, okay? The duo is like the 2026, but it holds two flashes at the same time. So that way you're getting more light. If you get more light by using two flashes, what happens is you can set each at a lower power and they'll cycle faster. So you can shoot, because you have, if you're shooting with a flash, you can't go click, 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 because the flash will keep up with you. But you can shoot faster if you use two flashes set at lower powers and getting the same amount of light out, because they'll cycle faster. And they also have, as you can see, they also, like I said, it's like an umbrella. They also have a little disc you can put in front of this, so it makes it like what we call a, not a softbox, a beauty dish. Beauty dish. Beauty, yeah, they use them and I use them for pets too, but they do them a lot in modeling. They have a beauty dish, and it's a very round light, and it gives a very harsh light in a sense, but round, and they use them for beauty shots, and this can be used like that, but instead of being hard like a regular beauty dish is made out of aluminum and everything, this folds up like an umbrella. So this happens to be one of my most popular items, is the Westcott rapid boxes. And this would be more, not for you shooting your family pet though. This is somebody that wants to go into it to make some money. The other items I mentioned would be for people looking to shoot family pets or their own pets. That's when you'd be looking at the other items I mentioned, like the Rogue flash benders and that, because they're gonna be more within your price range and they'll do a good job for you. Not all images are done high key. This one was taken using high speed sync and several flashes, speed lights. Black on black in the background. There's a little bit of green showing on the background, you can see. Well, you know, when you shoot a flash, it has to sync with the camera. And most of them are set to sync between 1/200th of a second max or 1/250th of a second, all right? There's a lot of cameras coming out today that'll do high-speed sync where you can actually set the camera to 1/8,000th of a second, up to 1/8,000th of a second, and use a flash. Now, in the past, if you did anything like that, you'd actually get part of the shutter in the picture because the shutter wasn't getting out of the way. The cameras that allow you to do this today, and a lot of the new cameras have this feature, what they're doing is it's actually shooting a series of flashes very quickly. So as the shutter's moving, it's actually flashing in between. And to you, it looks like one big flash, but it's a bunch of flashes. But it allows you, by shooting a very high-speed sync, very little background light comes in, to none. So the flash is the only light that's really lighting the subject, and you can darken the backgrounds. So if you've got a really bright sunny day and you have you caught out there and it's a real sunny day and you want to get that darker background or maybe a little more rich color on the beach during the day, then use, if your camera has the ability for high speed sync, okay, and again, check your camera, then you can use that along with your flash to get you a darker background and get you the proper exposure on your subject. But you'll need a little more flash power to do it. For the most part, it's dogs and cats, and that's what I kept this on to. Horses and birds and other things are a whole different story. remembering the pet's name, getting the right pet image to the right person. Is Boozer. Client is D. Martin. Okay. I shoot a whiteboard. If I'm shooting several pets, or even for one person several pets, if they're gonna be individual shots, I write down and shoot that whiteboard first with the client's name and the date, etc. So then I know that that series of shots is that dog. And if you're shooting commercially sometimes, like I said one time, I was shooting January outside with a whole bunch of dogs in a short period of time, how am I supposed to remember which dog is who? Dog came up, the first thing we shot was that. We put the dog's name, the owner's name, and the date. I put it right in front. I just photograph it. Hold it out there and take a shot of it. Yeah, I just use a whiteboard. And you can wipe it off and put the next one down on. And that. So I just put that out there. I shoot it. And now I know which animal for that series. Then when I come to the next series of animal shots, because it's all going to be on the same card, I know that this series is this. And so if it's several people, several animals, I know what it is. Easiest way to keep track of the animals if you're going to be shooting more than one animal or doing it commercially. Prep the pet and prep for the pet. Make sure the pet has been groomed recently, not 3 months before you're going to shoot them. So this is part of the pre-meet, so they know when to groom, okay? And you know when you're going to shoot, and it should be very close to the same time. If it's a dog, make sure he's been walked. So, you know, so he does things not when you're doing the shoot, okay? With a cat, play with him beforehand to try to, tire him out a little bit so he's not quite as rambunctious. Same with some dogs. Get rid of leashes in post-production, okay? You see he has a leash on the bottom, the brown leash? Pink leash is part of his decoration. No brown leash. Okay. Now the reason you don't get rid of the leash sometimes beforehand is the leash is necessary to keep the pet under control, and you must remember the safety of the pet is the first concern. That's utmost over anything. So you don't remove things that will allow the pet to get into trouble by not having control. Things like that you can remove in post-production. Okay? Now what about outfits? Well, as you know, people have outfits on the dogs and the cats, etc. So you're going to have to work around the outfits, and that's part of your pre-meeting again. If they're going to put an outfit on, if it's going to be Christmas decorations, whatever, you have to know that's what you're going to be shooting for and plan for that so that you're basically ready for that with what you're going to do with your backgrounds. You bring a background in, you're going to go shoot outside. You make sure everything is going to match the outfit. You know, you're not going to go out in the summer and the dog is wearing, you know, a Christmas outfit. So you want to make sure everything, and because they're dressing them all up today. I don't think the pets really care, but the people seem to love it, okay? And preset the lighting for the background before you start shooting, and set up a mood board. You know what a mood board is? Ever heard of a mood board? You have the customer go over stuff, take out pictures from magazines that they like and paste them onto a board of things they like or they've seen of pets, etc., or pets in certain backgrounds and that. And then they send that to you. You may work on your own before the final one, but it shows you different colors, different animal poses they may like, different looks they may like. And it's called a mood board. They use it for actually for modeling shoots too. When you're gonna shoot a model and that, or you're gonna shoot a certain style of something with a model, they set up a mood board first. So you have some idea. It can be a brick background, an old building, and it's gonna be a modern look, whatever. You can do the same thing with the pets. So you have some idea by the owner cutting out these pictures or getting them online and putting them onto something, a Facebook page or wherever you can see them, of things they like or looks they like. So then you could help them get that look in the final shoot. If possible, work with an assistant who's an animal trainer. If you know somebody in your area who trains animals, see if you can get them to work with you. Not the owner, Okay, you want to have a professional pet handler. Even if it's the person's own dog, if you can, sometimes if you have somebody that you know can handle an animal, especially if you're doing this for financial gain, these are things you want to invest in ahead of time. You want to have somebody professionally that knows how to handle the animal. It'll help you control the animal better for your shots. A professional handler is usually better to work with you than the owner, but if not, you have to work with the owner. But again, make sure the owner understands what they have to do. Okay. In the studio client's home, like I mentioned, I use paper backgrounds because they can be cut off when it's completed. Usually you have to throw the paper away. They're either feet are dirty or there's hair on it, whatever. So that's why paper is usually pretty good. But there are times when you're going to have to bring in a cloth background if you're going to shoot inside. Or when you're doing the pre-meet, you may look around the house for props. There may be a certain chair or a certain place that you're going to place them in-house that's going to require you have a wide-angle shot to show the whole scene. It may be part of the whole mood you're putting together. A very regal dog on with a fireplace in the background, etc., may be part of your whole shoot. So you have to set up for that, too. So again, that's I keep on going back to that pre-meet so you can really get a plan of what's going to go on. It's going to change by the animal, and by the be the animals and the type of animal and the, how the animal acts. So, but this is all part of things you're going to pre-check. If you can do a table sometimes, that's better so that, you know, but if you're going to use anything you're going to do, you got to make sure the animal is not going to fall off and be protected. So somebody has to be very close to those animals. Either the owner or a trainer has to be really close there. But the best place for the owner, okay, the best place for the owner is, I think I mentioned before, is directly behind you. That's how you get the animals to do what you want, by having the owner right there. But you want to check for any restrictions. If you can go to any parks or beaches, you want to make sure there's no restrictions for pets and have the owner prepared to clean up after the pet. So you want to go over that stuff with them. Not every park or location allows pets, since some places will charge you. So you want to check for that. If you're going to shoot like commercially like that, they want to charge you, so check with that stuff. Special equipment that you need for photographing animals. A steak, and not the one you eat, okay? These are things that you're going to need on occasions, because the animal has to be, sometimes you have to have the animal stay on a lead or a leash, all right? So you'll be at a location where you're going to not have another person, but the animal has to stay on this leash, and the leash can come out in post-production, like I showed you the collar before. So this stake is designed to drive into the ground in certain areas, so then you can attach the leash to it, and the animal is going to basically stay in position. Tennis balls. These are other props you can bring. I usually like to have, and I'll mention this later again, I'm sure, I like the owner to bring the pet's toys, because they usually have favorite toys. Noisemakers, duck calls, squeakers, anything like that, have the owner bring or have your own. Okay, noises attract the animals and get the animals to look up. A noise will do that for you, okay? And that noise maker or that distraction should be held over your lens. So if somebody's helping you, they're reaching over you right above your lens, and that's where they're putting the distraction. So the animal's looking up towards your lens. Okay, they're not out here, they're not down there, not over here, it's over the lens, all right? Because that's where you want the animal to look. Note, if you're doing this professionally, these items are tax deductible. So if you go into the pet store and you buy a bunch of this stuff, you can claim it as a tax deduction, all right? The other thing is a pop-up water bowl. They make up pop-up water bowls. I usually like to have them, whether it's a dog or cat with me, if I'm out on location, and a bottle of water in case the pet gets thirsty. So these are things that you can buy and you should have with you. The treats, now that's another thing. I like the owner to basically handle the treats because he knows what they like, and there's certain treats that animals may not be allowed because of dietary needs. So this again, on the pre-meeting, this is all stuff you want to go over and say, is the dog allergic to anything? Would you bring the proper treats that the dog likes, etc., cat likes, whatever, okay? Keeping the pet interested, okay? With pets, it's all about the expressions, the pose of the body. Some pets respond to commands better than others, like dogs versus cats. And like I said, cats understand the command, they just don't care about the command. And that. So for instance, oh, are we done yet? So you gotta try to keep them interested. There's gonna be obviously a certain amount of time frame when the animal's gonna say, that's it, enough is enough, okay? This may be another reason you have to come back, because if you're shooting for an album, that pet may have enough is enough before you finish getting all your images. So I promise that I get the shots, but I make sure I charge enough money that it makes worth for me to come back. I don't give away my images. Whatever you need the pet to do, they'll do the direct opposite. They look this way, they look the other way. They're famous for showing their rear ends rather than their faces. That's just what they do. So you have the favorite toy available. That's going to keep the attention. Again, the treats. Dogs love peanut butter, by the way. However, certain brands have additives that they shouldn't have. So I recommend organic. And I again check with the owner to find out. And it's small amounts. They also like cream cheese and canned pumpkins. So these are things that you can do. Sounds attract both cats and dogs. So there are sounds now for your iPhone that you can actually get that'll make noises that'll attract them if you wanted to too. But usually the duck calls and the squeakers and that work fine. And a lot of the owners will already have this stuff, but if not, you should carry a few of your own at all times in case they don't have it and you need something, or there's a sound they're so used to they're not gonna respond to it, and you come up with something new that they never heard before. So that's why it's good to have your own available too. So you wanna do that. Getting in position. This is very important. Don't shoot down, okay? Most of the times you want to stay at eye level or above. You don't want to shoot down at the animal. That's not a very pleasing look for the animal. Sometimes you may have to, but on the whole, if you look at most of my shots here, the animal's eye level with me, or I'm below him and shooting up at him. I'm not shooting down at the animal. And that, so you want to try to give the animal a more regal look to him. You want to basically do the eye level or below. You know, so be ready to get down on the ground. Be with the animal. See what the animal sees. You know, animals don't see things from our perspective. They see it from theirs. And you want to be shooting from that perspective. So be ready to get low or move them high. But I prefer, if possible, to be down on the ground with them. It's hard getting up, I know. You get older, it's hard getting up, but eyes, okay? Any good pet photo, like any other photo, eyes have to be sharp. That's important. Eyes have to be sharp. Ready for my close-up, Mr. DeMille, okay? And again, this can be part of a crop, or this could be the actual image that you take. So when you're looking at the images, sometimes you look at the image, you say, the body's not cropped, but the head looks beautiful. So you're going to crop in. And this is where a good quality lens, again, and a good quality sensor comes in, because it allows you to get in really close and keep all that fine detail. And if you look, you see the spots in the eyes, the white spots, that's lighting. Without those little spots, it kind of gets just black eyes. Those two little spots give a little bit of color, to a little shot up to the eyes, along with the color that comes with the eyes, brings it all out. And still keeping the lighting is also keeping the texture of the fur in place. You want to see that texture of the fur. Remember, they're not all show dogs. But to the owner, they are. Okay? They're not all show dogs that you're going to photograph. That's not a show dog. I could change that and put that eye post-production so he has two eyes, but that's not him. So you do the best with what they're giving you. To them, it's a show dog. All right? So they're not all going to be the beautiful show dogs or show cats that you get to photograph if you're doing it for other people. If you thought one was hard, try working with two.
Yeah.
Okay? Now is when you bring out the whiskey. Then go for broke and do three. And now we have two white ones and one dark brown one. So it's all balancing out the color tones just right. And obviously it was a Christmas shoot. Okay? Now it's going to time to get better depth of field because we have three animals in here. So now we're going to shoot for both the white background, but we're also going to make sure we have at least F8 or more for our depth of field because we have more animals to get in focus. So you got to keep that in mind now because you have to shoot greater depth of field. So you'll compensate for that. Working tethered, if I'm shooting working tethered, there's several things I use. One thing I shoot with is a cam ranger, which basically means that that's wireless. I'm just plugged from this into the camera, and then this wirelessly goes to my tablet. Okay? If the other way is if I'm shooting tethered with a strap, I use what we call a jerk stopper. All right? It's not somebody I know. It's a piece of a part that goes on the camera. And you can see it attaches to the camera and to the cable that's going into the camera. That way, if somebody pulls it, it doesn't damage my camera. It's made by a company called Tether Tools. They make a lot of, if you're going to have to shoot tethered, check into Tether Tools. They make cables specially designed to increase the length of your cable. You use your camera's cable, which is USB on one end, attaches to this on the other end, and then into the computer. It extends it 30 and 60 foot lengths, but they do have boosters they make to go in between. So because the longer you go, you lose signal strength. And that, so they do this, they have things like that, but it's a company called Tether Tools that I use. And then of course there's post-production. And for that I usually recommend, and for tethered shooting, you need to have a program that holds tethered shooting. Lightroom does tethered shooting. Captured One does tethered shooting. There's some programs, but you need to have a program. You can't just have tethered shooting. It has to have something to go into, something that supports it. If you're using the cam ranger, that comes with its own program that allows tethering into the tablet, okay? And they also have support where other people can look at through their tablets and see what you're shooting if you give them the address, the IP address. So with the cam ranger, you can have what we call photo share. So if other people have tablets while you're shooting, they can be looking at their tablets and see what's coming on. So if you have the owner has a tablet, et cetera, you can do that too. And then, of course, there's the package where you buy. Today, you can buy Lightroom separately or Photoshop 6, but now it's usually you usually pay for it by month online. It's about $10 a month for both Lightroom and Photoshop. And that's preferred because as it's updated, you can update your version. If you buy the version like Lightroom 6, there's certain things it will not do and certain updates it will not take. Lightroom CC will actually download to your tablet too, so you have it on both. And with that, I have to say, that's it, I'm beat. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.